morning. If you will please stand, and we will sing the summons together. Oh, no, no, no. Good morning. Slide by. So today is one of the most special days of our church year. Today we celebrate what? Who hollered Pentecost? Ah, there you go. Kate hollered Pentecost. Today we celebrate Pentecost. And for us as Christians, it is a mark for the beginning of what we call church. It's a very special day, and I hope that you all will engage with me as we go through a very, what I believe to be a very special and moving service between you and God, not you and me or you and one another, but just this time with God that you will have today. It's hard to believe that we're in the 21st century, and I want you to think when the church began, first century, centuries that the church has been around and has stood the test of time. And I believe with all my heart of hearts that no matter what we are facing today, there's church splits in our denomination, there's churches closing everywhere you turn, there's people leaving the faith, yet God is faithful. And I believe if for 21 centuries we've had the church, that we will have them for 21 more. And I hope that you will believe that as well, and that you will put your hope and your trust and your faith in God today in a new and profound way. We're so glad that you're here. We're glad for all of the guests are with us today. We ask Next week, I'm going to be asking you to do some things. I'll explain a little bit more about guest and inviting. So be prepared to listen for that in just a few moments. But for now, let's go to our God in prayer. God, I am so thankful to see folks here in worship today, those who I haven't seen in a while, those who are family members that are visiting from out of town. There are people here today, God, that are still struggling for their family to accept them and the stress that comes with that. There are people here today that we're missing, that we used to sing week in and week out, and then they've drifted away or they've left, and sometimes that's hard. There are people here today who are hurting and are in need of something profound and transforming and powerful. Wherever you are today, I know and I trust and I believe that God is with you. You may not feel God's presence, but God is there. And if you look up, God's arms will be open to you, saying, I can take this problem. Give me your heart. I've got you. And it is the absolute best feeling in the world. And so, Lord, I pray that we would all prepare our hearts as we worship together to receive you in that profound way, so that we can use this faith that we have found to help reshape the world around us. It is in your holy name that we pray. Amen. Let's take just a couple of minutes. Let's give each other a wave or a fist bump. Let's say good morning to everyone. Hello, Facebook family. Let me hear from you. Let's stand and greet one another in the name of Christ.
All right, if everybody will remain standing and sing with us today. As you find your seats, we're going to sing The Stand. Completely to you. So what can I say? And what could I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul.
Children's moment. I'm really excited about some things that Sandy is doing with our children. And when she leaves and takes them from here, she does the rest of the service with them. So they're going to be learning how to do tithes and offerings and prayers of the people and creeds and all that kind of stuff. I'm really excited about that. But today, I got it for you. Hey, kiddos. How are y'all?
Good morning, guys. Remember, if you're going to sit there, don't touch that. Okay. Good morning. Good morning. So let me ask you a question. How many of you have a birthday? Gwen has a birthday. Beckett, does everybody else have a birthday? Everyone on earth has a birthday. Yours is in December. Mine is in December, too, so it's cool. Look, but what do you like to get for your birthday? What are some great things that you like about birthdays? Dyson?
Say that again.
Bulbous gift cards.
What do you like to get for your birthday?
All the presents if your family and friends join you.
Oh, awesome. And one more. Elle, what do you like to get for your birthday?
Dog.
Oh, you hear that, Mom? Okay, hold on. So, yeah, these are some great things that we like to get for our birthday. We like gifts, right? We like gifts. So guess what? Did you know that the church has a birthday? Not just St. Francis, but all of the churches, all of the Christian churches in the world. We have one birthday that we share. Do you know when that is? Today. It's today. And it's Pentecost. It's the church's birthday. Isn't that cool? We'll talk about it a little more when we go into children's church. So the church is older than me. So, yeah. But guess what? On the church's birthday, God gave us something. God gave us a gift. Do you know what gift that was? Well, God did give us the earth. Yes, but on the church's birthday, God gave us the... Yes, I knew you knew it. The Holy Spirit. Yes. And the Holy Spirit was sent here to be a comforter and a reminder to us that God is always with us. He's always hearing us, and he always hears our prayers. So do you think that's something we should say thank you to God for? So let's pray and let's say thank you to God for the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the Comforter. Thank you for the love that you show. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All righty, let's go.
As our ushers prepare to come forward for our tithes and offerings this morning, I want to highlight a few. Actually, I have a whole lot of announcements, but I'll try and do them fast. Today is the deadline to sign up for Lake Junaluska. If you are a youth and you want to go on the retreat, if you are an adult or a teenager, a college-age kid, and you want to go and help, please see Jonathan, text him, call him, email him, let him know about that. Also, tomorrow night, Monday night, we will have another session of our contemplative living, our prayers and all of that. I hope you'll come. We're going to meet right back here in the sanctuary. Doesn't matter if you've come before. Doesn't even matter if you've been doing it. I want you to come and experience that if you so feel led. Next Sunday, following worship, where's Benton? Oh, there's his hand. He's waving. Y'all look at Benton. He is going to lead another Safe Sanctuary training following worship. So if you're helping with Vacation Bible School, just stay. Go ahead and be trained. You know, really all of us should be trained because we're around our children and we want to help keep our children safe. And it's not just about things that we do, but it's also about things that we know and how to handle certain situations. So you want to be sure and be trained for that. Also, Vacation Bible School, if you have not registered, go ahead, go online, register with that. They are in looking for some folks to help with setting up. Where'd Heidi go? Oh, she has children's church, doesn't she? Looking for folks to help set up. We need packing boxes of all sizes. So if your neighbor is a United Methodist pastor, I can promise you they have boxes. And Amy and Bob just moved, and he said, we have boxes. Let me tell y'all about Amy and Bob's moving experience. He said this morning, Amy said, Bob is Job, and I'm Jobet. I'll just leave it there. It's been a journey, I think, to get there. Also, we need to borrow some tropical plants for scenery. You can put your name on it if you have any tropical plants. We have some here that we can use, but if you have any, they're looking for those too. I don't know what they're doing, but I think it sounds like a jungle is coming. I'm not sure. Also, room in the end. I think this is an ACT thing. Is this ACT? Yes, our seniors group, our ACT group, they are collecting toiletries, like the small travel toiletries for the homeless shelter called Room at the End. And there is a basket out there, and we'll be collecting that for quite some time. So if you want to, you know, like sometimes you go to the store, you just pick those things up because you're going on vacation, whatever. You know, grab a couple more, bring those back, put those in the basket. Travel-sized toiletry, including shampoo, conditioner, lotion, shave cream, toothpaste, toothbrushes, and then it says, et cetera. So we'll see about that. And hopefully, I'm going to mention this again today. There's some additional save the date or actually not save the date. There's some registration cards that you can be looking for Feed the Hunger. It has a QR code on it. You can just register from there. Be on the lookout for those. They will be coming. But for now, I just ask you today, it's kind of like what Sandy said. Jesus brought us the Holy Spirit. And should we be thankful that Jesus brought us the Spirit to lead and guide and comfort and teach and give us the insights that we need? And the answer is, yeah, we should be thankful. And so I ask today to be thankful as you give your tithes and offerings. And I think that we have learned and we continue to learn, if you will give to God first, the blessings that follow that leave you astounded. If our ushers would please come forward. Oh, and the choir come up. Sorry. Y'all don't have to wait on me to tell you, because you know I'm going to forget. I invite you to come and join me at the altar. We will spend a short period of time today just kind of in some contemplative prayer and conversation with God, lifting up those folks that maybe the Lord is laying on your heart, and then I will bring us into a more corporate prayer time for us to kind of center ourselves to hear God in a deeper way. Let's go to God in prayer. God, I think it's only fitting that today we pray for our church. We pray for the church and the people who are in the church. It's a struggle, and I think that sometimes, God, we don't realize how much our culture has pulled us away. It just kind of happens, and we end up where we would be in church every week to now maybe we're not so much. Maybe it's every other week. Maybe it's every 6 weeks. Maybe it's twice a year. But yet we still feel like we are faithful servants to you. And maybe we are. But God, help us as the church know how to change and grow as the culture changes and grows, yet still remain faithful. Faithful to who you are, faithful to what you have called us to be, faithful to becoming more like you. have given St. Francis a vision, and I believe it, clarity. And we are working very hard to be faithful in that. And so, Lord, where we are not faithful, convict us and show us that so that we can continue to build on the foundation already built and on top of it and on top of it and on top of it as the years go on, this foundation that is unbreakable, that we will point everyone to you. God, we pray this morning for the finances of our church. I think in the 30-some years this church has been around, St. Francis has been that church that struggles with money. Not all churches have that. They struggle with gossip, or they struggle with being closed off. We won't do that. We are welcoming and inviting, and all can come. But we turn and give our finances to you new and fresh today. And we ask, Lord, that you just help us be good stewards and to have faith and to trust and to help us get to a place where, wow, we're like, man, I can't think of anything other than God who has helped us get to where we are now. I pray, Lord, and I lift to you our Sunday school classes, holding on to learning about you is difficult in this culture. It almost feels like Sunday school is a lost art. It's a lost gift. But we pray, Lord, for our classes and that teachers will come and people will attend, and it will be a priority once again that we will bring our children to learn the foundations of our Christian history, of our church history, of our Methodist history, that we will learn so that we can share with others. And Lord, I lift up this morning all of those names who are on our prayer list, our church members, our friends and family. It is never far away of something that we are struggling with that we need to pray for. And God, on this anniversary of the church, maybe now more so than any other day of the year, you remind us that we are disciples of Jesus Christ. That is what we have chosen to be. That is what you have called us to be. So may we join in those century-old prayer called the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever, God. Amen.
If you will remain seated, we are going to sing Spirit of the Living God, hymn number 393, two times through.
Fresh on me.
We're starting a new series. It's called Proclaim. And I want us to take this word proclaim seriously, because it's what we are supposed to be doing, proclaiming the good news and all that we say and all that we do. And so one of the things that's going to start next week, so you have a whole week to begin to think about it, okay? You're going to come in at some point this week, I'm not exactly sure what day, and you're going to see this big, huge banner out front. And next week, you're going to have an opportunity to grab a light bulb, okay? Like an outdoor light bulb, string lights, light bulb. And you're going to be able to take that home with you if you want to. You can even leave it here if you want to and pray without it. But what I'm going to be asking you to do next week is to get a light bulb, and you're going to take that light bulb, and you're going to write names on that light bulb. People that you know who do not know Jesus Christ. People that you know who have fallen away from the church. Your neighbors, your friends, your family. And I'm going to ask you to be so bold as to write their names, young and old, on that light bulb. And when you have prayed for them and you have found the courage to invite them, I'm going to ask you to bring that light bulb back and put it in that string of lights, and we're going to light up that whole corner to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ with one another. See, that's what this day is about. And God is calling us not just to be faithful for us, but God is calling us to be faithful to God, to point others to God, and to bring others to God. And it's time we begin to practice that. Some of you are sitting there going, I know exactly who's going on my light bulb. And that's a good thing, because we have to trust and believe that our God and the power of our God is bigger than our resistance. That our God is bigger than our fear. So I want you to pray about that, because it's all going to be in response to our scripture today, to our lesson today. We know that in Acts chapter 2, the disciples had been afraid. They were in the upper room. They were hiding out. They didn't know what to do. Jesus had been crucified, and now he's ascended. And they're like, whoa, that just happened. Now what? And so as they sat there, we know from our scripture that the Holy Spirit came and filled them in a profound way. Number one, they were all together. Number two, remember the scripture tells us that this sound came like a violent rushing wind and filled the whole house, and divided tongues as a fire appeared and rested on each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in all the various languages. And what we call this is Pentecost. Pentecoste. 50 days after the crucifixion. But here's something that we mess up. Is we think that Pentecost is about the Spirit coming, but that's not at all what Pentecost was then. It was a Jewish festival, the Feast of Weeks. It was about harvest and bringing your harvest, this early harvest, to Jerusalem as a sacrifice to turn that stuff in, to not turn it in, but to give it over to God. To be faithful, all men were required to come so they would bring their families as well, I'm sure. It was a celebration of the beginning of the early wheat harvest. And that meant that Pentecost always fell sometime during the middle of May or in early June. Now, we know that there's all kinds of festivals, right? Remember, we started with Passover. And all these festivals were to point people to God and for them to be obedient to demonstrating how they are giving their first to God, their first fruits. And this is the day, the beginning of this festival of the weeks, the beginning of this festival where all the people were going to be gathered in Jerusalem. This is the day that Jesus Christ decided to send the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit was going to show up. Isn't that kind of cool? It wasn't like the Holy Spirit showed up with all them in the upper room and then they sat around and prayed about what they were going to do next. No, Jesus doesn't do anything small. He did it with a bang, right? It was like, here we go. Jesus had ascended. People had traveled for days and weeks and miles to get there. And clearly, Jesus picked the right moment. And on this day, when they were filled, there were people who doubted. There were people who doubted. There were people who questioned. There were people who accepted. Does that sound familiar to us? It's kind of the same thing all the way around. And so what happens is they start questioning them about them being drunk and all of that. And then there was Peter. Peter, who had doubted. Peter, who had denied. Peter, who was the ADD-er. Peter, who was the hothead. Peter stood up. Not because he thought, well, I'm going to show them. That's not why Peter stood up. I'm going to tell them. That's not why Peter stood up. Peter stood up because Peter had been filled with the Holy Spirit and knew, I have to speak. I can't let this go on. And I'm going to read you the very first sermon of the very first church found in Acts chapter 2. I'm going to start in verse 14. Follow along with me if you want to, because I'm going to read a lot. I'm going to read through verse 36. And I want you to catch it. So all this took place, all the questioning. And verse 14 says, but Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I have to say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. So number one, he's quoting scripture. They're going to know the scripture. And people are prophesying. People are dreaming. People are thinking about the future. And they said, this is going to come. And in verse 18, it says, even upon my slaves, both men and women in those days, I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy. That means, in my most humble of opinions, everybody will have the opportunity to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I will show my portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist, and the sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, shall be saved. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And then he says in verse 22, fellow Israelites, listen to what I have to say. I'm going to stop right there for a second. How many of you right now have zoned out? How many of you are sitting there saying, oh gosh, how much more scripture is she going to read? How many of you are sitting there and you're thinking, gosh, she doesn't normally read this much scripture. Is this going to be a long sermon? This is what that's what he's talking about. This is what I'm talking about. Peter's saying, listen. This is the best news you will ever hear in your life. And sometimes when you hear the worst news you've ever heard in your life, if you haven't listened to the best news you've ever heard in your life, what are you going to do? Peter is saying to these people, you killed this guy. I'll get to that in a minute. But he's still here. He says, Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power and wonders and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. This is the man that you handed over, crucified and killed. But God, come on. But God raised him up, God having released him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for him to be held in death's power. Do you believe that? Do you live that? Do you want everyone to know that same truth? For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One experience corruption. That comes straight from Psalm 16. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites. Maybe I should say fellow believers. Fellow Christians. Fellow followers of Jesus Christ. I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. For seeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. I'm almost done. This Jesus, God raised up. And of that, all of us are witnesses, being therefore exalted at the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit he has poured out, so that you can see and hear. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah. And when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. It's the word of God for the people of God. When they heard this, they were cut to the heart. And we know from Scripture that over 3,000 of those folks, men, women, children, even more, accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior on that one day, and thousands more in the days to come. We get excited if one person comes to our church. When did that happen? When did we become so complacent with the soul of our brother and sister? And the people in this scripture looked at Peter and they said, "Peter, what do we do?" Are you asking that question? How did I get from being part of this movement of people accepting Christ that has become normal and regular and routine to no one ever accepting Christ? I asked somebody in a church, I think it may have been this church. I ask this in every church. You don't have to hold your hand up because I already know the answer. How many people have you been in the presence of when they accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? And some of you are saying, none. I'm not talking about confirmation. Do you know that speaking of confirmation, with every kid that comes through and we confirm them, that we speak with them individually and say, are you ready to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Which means, are you ready to receive the power of the Holy Spirit? And there were some people that don't know how to do that. Are you one of them? Could you sit down and say, let me tell you how the Holy Spirit has filled me to the brim, to overflowing? That's what this day is. And if your answer is no, I'm not there. I used to be there and I'm not there anymore. It's okay. Maybe you're the person who's like, I'm not comfortable with that. That's an excuse. We're talking about Jesus. We're talking about salvation. We're talking about happiness and joy and contentment. We're talking about living a life to the absolute fullest that we can live it to, despite what goes wrong. How can we not want that for someone else? It's not that you can't, because the power of God says that you can. And it's time, through the grace of God, to start new and afresh with this movement here at this church. We have 600 people coming next door in just a couple of months. We have people all around us that right now are sitting at home arguing with their spouse or laying in bed, or watching something they shouldn't on TV, or contemplating, yeah, church. So what we're going to do is we're going to do what Peter told the folks to do way back at the very first church. What must we do? What shall we do? And Peter answered this way: repent and be baptized so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the Holy Spirit. This is what we're going to do today. We're going to spend some time repenting right now. Band's going to play. You can come to the altar. You can sit where you are. But it's time for us to say, God, I don't think I've been the disciple you've called me to be. And then we're going to repent, and then I'm going to bless the elements. And then Billy is going to lead you to come down for communion. And once again, I have our baptismal font here for you to touch that water to remember your baptism and what that means for your Christian journey. Let's spend some time repenting with our Lord. Give thanks to God that we have a memory that helps us remember ourselves back to our church. Where in that upper room, Jesus sat with his disciples and he said, every time you think about me, remember what I've done. Keep yourself aligned. Remember what I've told you to do. He broke bread and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, eat. Every time you eat of this, remember what I have done. When the dinner was over, he got the cup. When he poured it out, And they had no idea. They had no idea that on that night when he poured out that cup of wine, that they would also see his blood being poured out the next day. Because it's the only way that a stubborn human beings would ever get it is not with his presence with us, but with the Holy Spirit living in and through us. And I think in the back of Jesus' mind, he was thinking, remember this cup. Remember what it means to be filled. Remember that moment that you either realized in your spirit or in your mind of, whoa, Jesus is like real. Jesus is with us and for us. And this cup represents the forgiveness of sins at the redemption of hope. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, I ask that you would pour out your spirit on these gifts of bread and the cup, that you would make them be for us the body broken but put back together because of you. And this cup reminds us of our emptiness, but yet you fill us and you make us whole. May we cling to this today as we have repented and said, God, I'm so sorry, but I'm still here. And we will come and we will remember the sacrament of that baptism of being initiated into your church, into your kingdom, into your life with grace and mercy and goodness. And that through that, we are filled with the Spirit to go and to extend that grace and love to others. Thank you for this blessing. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. If our servers will come up. Unfortunately, we have to do these little cups again because of dear old COVID. Holy Spirit, get rid of COVID. A couple of things. Here you go, Patty, please come. If you'll get that. No, you stand right here. Okay. So there's the little cellophane on top to get your wafer, and then you have to open it up to get your cup. There's also, if you could help Billy, there's a trash can in the back that when you leave, you could maybe take your trash for him as well. So that's a little housekeeping stuff. The Spirit is alive and well. Come, the table is prepared for you.
Fullness of eternal promise, stirring in your sons and daughters, earth revealing heaven's wonders. Spirit, come. Spirit, come. What you spoke is now unfolding. All your children shall be holding. Dreams awaken in this moment. Spirit, come. Spirit, come. Pour it out. Let your love run over. Here and now. Let your glory fill this house. Pour it out. Let your love run over. Now the world awaits your presence, and this power is within us. We will rise to be your witness. Spirit, come. Spirit, come. Pour it out.
Different now than when you came? That's what I was trying to say. As you leave, please be in prayer and take seriously this power of the Holy Spirit in our life and the gift and the goodness that it brings. Luke, you can go on down. He's taken the light of Jesus out. Will you follow that light? Go in peace. Amen.
Tongues of fire, testifying of the sun. Whoa.